Good morning, people of God. Thank you so much for another. I would like to thank you for this other a new video that I would like to make. I mean, that I come to make. And I would like to say thank you to those who subscribe to my page and those who watch my videos and pass them to other people. Thank you. God bless you. I really appreciate your participation to my ministry, and I am grateful. I really am. And God bless you. I would like to talk today about prayer, fasting, and tithing. And those three elements are really necessary in a Christian's life. Let me start with prayer. There are so many kinds of prayers. I could talk to you about prayer for like days, but for the sake of this video, I'm just going to be brief. But the first one is the sinner's prayer that we all had to make, hopefully, and we recognize Christ as the Son of God, and we invited him in our lives, like he's our Lord and Master. That's the sinner's prayer. And by doing that prayer, then God will take you, God the Holy Spirit, and remove you from the darkness and from the world, and bring you into his kingdom and his light. And we all had to make that prayer, and that's how we entered and we were able to become children of God. And I'm grateful for that prayer because it changed my life. That's the best decision that I have ever had to make in my life. And the second kind of prayer, as someone who comes, my main concern, my main worry, my main target is Africa and its people, everywhere that they are. And every other ethnicity has its own kind of issues that comes from their ancestors and all that, because we all have ancestors. And I would like just to focus on Africa and our ways, and because I pray for Africa, that's my assignment. I'm a watchman for Africa. And so there we need to repent, because I was not there when my ancestors were alive. I saw my grandma, but not my grandpa. And so what I'm trying to say is that I was not there. I cannot swear, I cannot certify that I know, that I know, that I know everything that my ancestors did. And I've been living in this country for so long, I mean like more than 20 years, and I don't have that many African-American friends for many reasons that I didn't plan, or that I decided that I will not have black African-American friends, although I would love to have some. So the more I observe that group of my fellow Africans, Americans, I see that they have issues that studied in Africa. And that's the reason why I started doing these videos in English also, because I'm from Central Africa. We speak French. French is the official language, although Swahili is my language. I would not want to do a videos only in Swahili. That will narrow my audience, I mean people listening to me. So when I make videos in French, many people can hear me and understand, because in Central Africa, most of us are French-speaking people. But for African-Americans, they have so many issues that studied in Africa, that comes with ancestor worship, that comes with, that came from there. I don't know how many of them are aware of that. And I will be making other videos that are going to be disturbing, like they are going to move you from your comfort zone, you African Americans, because there's so much to be talk about, especially from my African eyes looking at you. And I learned a lot. I prayed for so many things. And so we were not there when our ancestors were alive. And the best way to go is to repent for what they did. You know, like the prayer of Nehemiah in the Bible, when he prays for the sins of my fathers and my mothers, I was not there, so but I just repent for the evil that they did. They must have had had sin, because we all fall short from the glory of God. We do, all of us. So repenting for that past is really good, because now when we deal with our ways and the divination, and in my family I see issues. You know, I think we have heard people say, oh, diabetes is our disease in our family. We are talking about it like it's something like a badge of honor or something. No, it's not ours. It's a plague that is bothering us. And it's a generational one, and we need to deal with it accordingly. So I cannot say, oh, everybody has a heart condition in my family. That's our disease. No, it's not mine. I refuse it. So we need to pray and go back to repent. And once we repent, now we ask the Holy Spirit. I had to do that. Ask the Holy Spirit. And as I made a list, an honest list of issues that I saw on my father's side, on my mother's side. And I started repenting for each evil, and then for each sin, and then asking God to come and bind. Because everywhere that you have, let's say diabetes, let's go back to a specific thing. There is a demon here that is standing next to the disease to see to it that the disease will not stop, that it will continue. So it's like a guard that is taking care of diabetes. So I had to pray to repent and then ask God to, because he gave me his power and authority. So it's a legal road. Not that God is legalist, because he's not, but we have an accuser of brethren, and that's what he does. In 17 years, Satan took me to court 4 times. I'm not joking. You know when people say that he's my lawyer in the courtroom? I've seen him be my lawyer in the courtroom. He's my doctor in the sick room. I saw that too. And I'm testifying that it's not a joke. It's not a pigment of our imagination, that maybe I've been traumatized by something and I'm seeing things. No, I'm fine, I'm sane. But what I'm saying is, we need to repent and then bind the spirit of diabetes and bind the demon that comes with it and send them at the feet of Jesus to be judged before their time. And now I start repenting, so diabetes doesn't have a chair to sit on in my family, because I remove the sin. So that's the process that I did for every other issue that I saw in my family. And of course, I didn't do that in 24 hours. I didn't do that by snapping my fingers, because it's real, especially when you have a big family. Many of us do. And it takes time. It takes time and perseverance. And that's how we should not give up. We need to ask the Holy Spirit for strength, because he's the only one who can do that. And with him on our side, you know, like a partner, we are working together. Then he will start showing you hidden things that you didn't know. Then you can pray accordingly and destroy them accordingly. So that's what I had to do. So when it comes for generational curses, like a generational barrenness, generational singleness, people who cannot be married, or women who cannot have many babies, or women who cannot have babies at all, you know, or men who have erectile dysfunction. So there are so many issues. Make a list of your problem. And another one is in this country with the prison pipeline system, men who go to jail, men or women in your family who went to jail, it's a curse. Because as soon as you go in a prison, I didn't talk about that in the French videos, because it's not that a big issue there on Africa soil that compared to here, here in the US, where I'm living. It's a curse. Once someone goes to jail, there is a cloth of that identify you. It's like you have a bull's eye in your back. And that's how you see your father went to jail, your grandpa went to jail, and you go to jail too. It's a generational thing. We need to deal with it. When you had a father who was a pimp, it's generational curse. When you have a father who was a drug dealer, it's another problem. Make a list of your issues, and one by one give it to God by repenting, and then removing Satan and that demon that is there, and that's how freedom and deliverance and liberty will come into the family. That's one kind of prayer. And that one requires discipline and a plan. It's really a plan, like my coming out plan. So, because many men did bad things, so another man must come and undo what was done. You know, like when you on your computer, do and undo, do and undo. It's a legal process, but we must go through it, all of us. And I did it, and I'm reaping the result. And I recommend to people. People look at me like, yeah, it's too long. God is mercy, His grace. Well, I don't know about you, but it's just that my calling is very serious, so I really need to watch my back. I really need to pay attention to what I'm doing, who I'm dealing with, what I'm doing, because I'm telling you, demons are real. I'm not scared of them, but they are real. And my decision when I started this ministry is not to take, to say, oh, it's just a little demon. I don't play with demons. I take you seriously. I take it seriously, without fear, because I have the victory. But I don't want to be so oblivious and hide into the grace, because now people are becoming stupid because of grace, and they are abusing and using that extreme grace. So that's for prayer, the prayer part, and then fasting. To me, prayer and fasting go together. I cannot do one without the other. Again, the best way to fast, the more efficacious one, like you are really destroying, is fasting according to what the Holy Spirit tells you, because He speaks, He is alive, and He has is our doctor, so He has your line of He's going to tell you what is required for your problem, because my problem might not be your problem. So He is our source, He is our teacher, He is our Lord, our Master, and He is the one with us here. So I will advise you to pray and ask Him what kind of fasting you need to do. I studied with the Daniel fast 21 days. He told me to sleep on the floor, to give up meat and fancy food, because I love to cook. So I would just have rice and vegetable without sauce, without, it was just like a food that you would give to a prisoner of some sort. I did that for 21 days, sleeping on the floor. I gave up my bed. I did that, and I saw that I could do it. So for two years, I slept on the floor. I'm not bragging, I'm just telling you what it took for me, because my issues were that serious. I needed too much. You know, you cannot come and deal with a serious infection and take one Advil. No, you need another kind of, you don't bring a knife, a small butter knife, that kind of fight. I had to go to another level. I had to do things that I've never done in my life. 2 years I slept on the floor, to the point that the day I went back on the bed, I was like, I need to go back on the floor, because the bed was too soft. I needed to go back on the floor. So that's what it took, and I did that. So fasting for, and then he gave me a break for like 2 years. I didn't fast, and then 3 years ago the Holy Spirit told me, he said, I need you to take to go to another level. I would like to elevate you, but you need to give me something. Because in the kingdom, we don't cut corners. You need to give me something too, because it's a give and take. Even Christ had to die to redeem us. So there is a price to pay for every anointing. There is a price to pay. And so 3 years ago, he asked me to sleep on the floor for every first week of the month. So he asked me to give him the first fruit of every month, and I've been doing that. Sometimes it would say 2 weeks, sometimes 3 weeks in 1 month, and then you go back on the bed for 1 week, and then you go back on the floor for but I did it, and there were days where I was like, I'm going to have a tantrum. I refuse, I will not do it. And then the enemy that was standing on my way had to be removed because of the fast. So I've learned how to obey. I've learned, because I saw that He's not a cruel God. He's not there to make me pay for something or to make me suffer. He doesn't take pleasure in it, but in order for a good olive to produce oil, it has to be crushed. I know, but that's the kingdom ways. And as he's doing that, as you are fasting, he's changing your mind, expanding your mind, expanding your scope, and broadening your shoulders so you can carry more things. And it's just amazing when you fast like that, because then you are so destructive to enemies that they cannot stop you. They cannot stop you because you are doing everything under the shadow of the Almighty, and you are going together with the Holy Spirit, and it's wonderful. I love it. I love it when I destroy things. I love it when I take back territories. I love it when I change things. And you watch in the news, something happened, something changed, but I know that I did it. I did it. Anyway, that's that's what fasting does. So I don't trust Christians who don't fast. I don't trust Christians who are so busy in the preaching and jumping, hopping from one conference to another, but they do not fast. I heard about people who have teams of people praying for them. I heard about people that are on a payroll to pray for such and such pastor. I don't respect that. I pray alone for myself. I pray alone for my ministry, and I'm alone when the Holy Spirit talks to me. So we are a team composed of two people, and I like it like that. So I don't know about the rest, but I don't have anyone interceding for me, and I would not recommend it anyway, because my battles are of another nature. So if you don't gird your waist well, it can be dangerous. It can be dangerous. So I like to do it myself, because I know how to clean up. I've closed up my life. You know, you need to make a list of your weaknesses too. I heard about people who will have sex with someone. They pay you $3,000 to go buy a Louis Vuitton purse or a Christian Dior purse. You need to know your weaknesses. You need to know what is your tipping point. You need to know that. And if you have many weaknesses in the flesh, then give it to God and ask him to help you to surmount that and to change that, because he's the only one who can help. And so you need to know yourself. Is it drugs? Is it sex? Is it alcohol? What is your weakness? Money? Random sex in bathrooms with strangers? You need to know in parking lots. You need to know what is your problem, and then give it to God, and he's going to help you. Because it's better to be honest anyway, because he sees you as you are. So with him, there is no need to have that facade like, yes, Lord, hallelujah, praise the Lord, but I'm hiding behind something. Who are we kidding? You know? We are reaping what we are sowing. So he sees everything, and nothing is hidden from his sight. So that's what fasting does. And the last portion is tithing. We need to tithe. I've seen the devourer, you know. One day I went to buy a TV, a 60-inch TV. I was very excited. 2 days after that, my TV died on me. I was like, it was still on the warranty, but I was pissed off. I was like, okay, so what do I do? Do I call them? They come and, I didn't know what to do. The Holy Spirit told me, he said, who gave you this TV? I said, you. He said, okay, unplug it. Read Malachi 10. I read the devourer and all that. He said, command to the devourer to leave and tell him that God gave me this TV. You don't have a right to be here. I unplugged the TV, went back to bed, came back an hour later, plugged back. The TV is working fine. I still have the same TV. So I did that for my laptop. I did that for my PC. I did that for my vacuum cleaner. I'm telling you, the devourer is real. And the only way to rebuke him and to take back what is yours is by tithing. That covenant is so minimized today by people that are stingy. You have one kind of people, it's very hard for them to give, even to God. It's very hard. But they don't complain when they receive, but when they give, it's very hard. You need to give, to be a giver. I saw the benefit of giving. I saw the benefit of tithing. It's like you have a bank account with God, and I've seen the benefit, I'm telling you. So if you put honest prayer with repentance and spiritual warfare, like I described to you in the first portion, fasting in the second, and tithing, you are going to reach new heights and victory. You are going to have victories with the Holy Spirit, because it's real. It's real, it's not a joke. I've been living like that for the past 17 years, and I wouldn't have it any other way, because I saw the benefit. I saw the healing. Would you believe me if I tell you that some days I went to bed under attack? I was so bad, I mean, so sick in my body, that I prayed and I said, Lord, you know what? If I die in my sleep, it's okay. I will not be mad at you. And then I would dream that I'm in a hospital, in an operating room, the light, the noise, everything. And they would do a surgery on me. And in the morning, he would tell me, don't lift weight, don't go to the gym for 3 days. And the disease left me, and I'm grateful. But that's a benefit that came with the cross. So I am here to tell you that God is real, the word is real, prayer works, fasting works, and tithing works also. And by putting all that together, that's the recipe for success. That's the recipe for progress and evolution in the kingdom, because we need to evolve, we need to go from glory to glory. I'm still debating things that I saw, if I should tell you about it, but I probably will. But I'm pretty sure that like a good 80% of you will not believe me. But you know, at this stage, I don't ask for money in my ministry. I never have. And I don't think that I will ever will, because I used to pray for so many people, with many people, like sometimes 50 per day. When I studied, I was building my house with prayer. No ministry can last if prayer is not a component of it. And because of my name, my family, my background, where we come from in the Congo, many people will refuse to sow seed in me, saying that, oh, she comes from a wealthy family, and or well-to-do family. So they will not do that. But they didn't know that by doing that, they blessed me even more, because the Holy Spirit, who is just and fair, came and gave me. And for many years, he didn't give me in money or material wealth, but he gave me in anointing. Because freely you have received, freely you will give. So when I see a pastor who has like a list, you know, like you go to McDonald's, a burger is $5, I pray for you 30 minutes, 100, this, 200, you will not go far with that. It has to be free. It has to come from love, agape love, that God-given love that we give to our fellow brothers. That's the best way to go. And I saw how he elevated me, how he gave me so much. And then that freedom to be able to say what I want, when I want, it's priceless. I don't want to lose that, because I'm blunt. I don't have a problem with telling the truth. I could talk to President Trump or to the Queen of England. I will tell them what I think, politely, but I will tell them what I think. So that freedom, I don't want to lose it, because I don't want to be bound and to receive dirty money from dirty people who will come with an agenda, like, you don't talk about this and then we'll provide for you. I don't want that. I love what I do. I love where I am. We are a team of two, the Holy Spirit and myself. And I want to be able to have that freedom of speech, that freedom of saying what he tells me to say, and without fearing about repercussion or what people will think about me. And it's really wonderful to be there, and it's priceless to me. So you can keep your money, and I keep my Holy Spirit. Thank you very much. God bless you.